Oh, it's real quiet in here. There's no music going. Eh? I was thinking, did everybody go home? Did I? Yeah. I was talking too long out there. Welcome. We're just delighted that you can all join us this morning. I want to make an announcement first of all, and then we'll get into the swing of things. On behalf of the PNC, we're excited to inform you that by unanimous consent, we've extended a pastoral call, and the better news is that the candidate has accepted this call to come here as the new pastor. At this point, it's prudent to maintain confidentiality of the person's identity because they have not told their own church yet. So we're keeping it quiet, no names being divulged yet. We will pass along more details of the candidate when possible. In the meantime, it's important that everyone understands the process and begin planning for a congregational meeting in the coming weeks, which the candidate will preach at. And it's our desire to move along as quickly as possible. The 8:15 service, we've got a round of applause for the PNC, and there's some of them here this morning. But a bigger round of applause for God for providing the right person at the right time. So this is one of those times. You see, when emails come out from the church now, you need to read them. All right? You don't need to go, there's Keith sending us another email, or John. So please read them. You'll get more information and you'll hear more things. So thank you for joining us this morning in person, also online at worship at 9 as we celebrate communion today. We love sharing and worship with you all, and we hope that God really blesses you as you spend some time here. Please fill out your connection cards. There's a little card in front of you. I haven't got it to hand. I've been carrying other things around, so I forgot about that. Please fill that in, drop that in at the back to the offering box as you leave, and that would be wonderful. We had a work day last week at Lincoln School, and fabulous, just a brilliant day. And next Sunday, we're off on our travels again. So please don't come here next Sunday. We're at Sellers Farm out on Wilson Road, just across from Willowbrook. It's going to be a real celebration, great time. We're going to have food. We're going to have games and just time for the whole family. So please bring family, bring friends. Great to see new faces, and you're more than welcome and most welcome with us today. We're excited about that. We hope you enjoy it. So ask and bring, and we're going to have a great time. Bring your lawn chairs, please, and bring those with you. Bring a blanket, a rug, whatever you want to do, and it's just very relaxed. It's going to be a beautiful day. Should be in the sort of, I've had a conversation with God. Told him I'd like it in the sort of mid-70s, you know, so I think he'll provide. I think he will. So it's going to be good. Bring some sunscreen, just in case. But it's going to be a real family day of worship, cookout, fun activities, and we're excited about that. The schools are back, colleges are back, people are getting back in the routine. So we want to start off today's worship by just thinking of all those in education and what this year holds. Just watch our screens.
Thank you, God, for the gift of education, for our children's desire to learn and grow, for friends who have similar interests but who challenge them in new ways too. We pray their educators are inspired and energized every day by their calling. We pray this year would be led by you. Each day they would step through the door you open. Keep them safely protected, and may you bless them with opportunities to be a light to others as they learn more about you. We ask for wisdom and strength to raise them up in the purpose and plan you have for me and the truth of your word. Amen.
Say earlier, before you leave, if you're new here, come and see me. I want to give you a little gift, but also would love just to hang out in the back of church there with some coffee and just get conversation. So let's worship. This is called Great Things.
Thank you. what kind of man welcomes the company of the hurting, helpless, and the hopeless?
What kind of a man can heal the pain with a single soft touch?
What kind of a man multiplies hope and freedom as easily as he does fish and bread?
Who else can turn our dusty old religion into a brand new relationship?
What kind of man would claim to be God in the flesh, but then allow that same flesh to be torn apart?
What kind of a man would embrace betrayal?
Insults.
Torture.
Mockery.
And death.
And yet, live to tell about it.
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody.
Who could speak with such authoritative words and yet drench them with compassion?
Who could be strong enough to still the storms, yet be so meek and humble?
Who could allow the hands that created the universe to also be nailed into a wooden cross?
Who could choose patience despite deserving immediate and complete obedience?
Who could be blameless and without fault, but still endure the judgment others deserve?
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody but Jesus.
Nobody. Who will love us like him? Who will be with us when all others have left?
Who comforts us in suffering?
Who is our peace in the midst of anxiety?
Who reassures me when my mind is drowning in doubt?
Who accepts me as I am, with no strings attached?
Who else would die for me while I was sinking in sin?
Who else can turn the grave into Easter morning?
Nobody.
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 Nobody but Jesus.
Colossians 1 and verse 27. God wanted everyone, not just Jews, to know this rich and glorious secret inside and out, regardless of their background, regardless of their religious standing. The mystery, in a nutshell, is just this. Christ is in you. Therefore, you can look forward to sharing in God's glory. It's as simple as that. That is the substance of our message. You know, often we live in this world that tries to complicate everything, doesn't it? You know, we try and complicate everything that's going on. And yet the message is simple. It's all about Jesus. I don't know about you, but do you ever feel that it just seems that every day all you hear is bad news? It's always bad news. You know, you turn on the TV, you turn on a news station, and it's just disaster after disaster, one thing after another, and you're just bombarded with all this bad news. You look on your social media feed, and you find all this bad news, usually somebody complaining about something, and it just seems to go on and on. It just seems to be doom and gloom everywhere. Well, today is different here, because it's the same as any other day. We have good news, and we have good news to proclaim. We have good news that is far outweighs anything else. In fact, it's not good news, it's great news for all who follow Jesus. And this is the news that we are supposed to share. When all's going wrong, one thing remains, and that's Jesus. No matter what's happening in life, the one thing we can depend on is Jesus. Our scripture told us this morning here, in a nutshell, I love this bit, this is all taken from the Message version. In a nutshell, this is it. Christ is in you, and so you can be sure of sharing in God's glory. When Christ is in us, the news is great. The news is wonderful. It's plain and simple. When Jesus is living in us, we have all that we need. Can we get that into our heads? When Jesus is in us and with us, it's all we need. We may desire other things, but we don't need other things. We need Jesus first. He makes us complete. And we become more like him every day that we spend with him. He rubs up and rubs off on us, I suppose you would say. We start to become more and more like him. We take on his very nature. We take on his power. Because Jesus reigns inside us. And boy, I find that, I don't know about you, but I find that really hard to comprehend and to take in. You know, that if Jesus is living inside me, there is nothing that I can't do. There's nothing that you can't do when it's in his will. Isn't that fantastic? Isn't that great news that people need to hear about? People need to hear that the only one that makes a difference, as our video said, is Jesus. And we don't deserve any of it, but he still gives it to us. That's the God that we serve. That's the God who loves us. So the power of Jesus is inside every one of us. We're able to do more than we can even imagine, and yet we don't tap into this power source. We try to get by on our own, don't we? We try to get by on our own. We need the power of Jesus active and working in our lives. And this is a message for everyone, everybody here, everybody listening online and watching online. This is a message for you. It's a message for everyone, for the marginalized, for those who think they're unheard and unseen, for every person, no matter what race or creed, for the rich and the poor. You know, Jennifer and I, we were down here early as usual on a Sunday morning. We can never beat John here. John's here from the scrake of dawn, I think. But we try and get here early, but John always beats us by a long way. But there was a great picture this morning. Well, it wasn't a great picture, but as we pulled into the car park, there was a man going through the big dumpsters from the school. Now, he got onto his bike and rode away. That man needs hope. That man needs to know that Jesus cares, because our Jesus is for that person as well as for each one of us. It doesn't matter who you are. Jesus is saying, just come to me. I can give you hope. All the things that you're missing in life, I can give you. I can walk alongside you. I can be there for you. You see, we live in a bubble, and we live in this world that at times we think everything's great. Or, well, things are a wee bit tough, you know. We went to the store today, and we couldn't actually get that exact product that we wanted. And it seems as if the end of the world's coming, you know. What am I going to do? I can't get this. And then you see a man rummaging through a dumpster. It puts things in a different perspective, doesn't it? Because he would have loved to rummage through your kitchen just to find some of the stuff that we have there. And he doesn't care whether it's out of date or not. He just needs something. We all need something. The first thing that we need is Jesus in our lives. So important. Jesus wants us. He wants us for his own. He wants to be beside us. He doesn't care about our background or our religious beliefs are. It doesn't matter to him. You matter. We matter. The individual matters. He doesn't get anybody to take a test to get to know him, to pass and be able to come to him. He just asks us to give of ourselves. And at times when everything feels as if this is done, there's nothing else I can do, Jesus remains strong and remains firm. This morning, my friends, he wants to have a relationship with each one of us. And not a fleeting relationship. You know that sort of, you walk by and you go to somebody, hi. And I have an awful habit of this now. I apologize to everybody now. But at times you'll go, so, Hiya, how's your day? And you keep on walking, and the person's answering you, and you're already 10 steps down the street. You know, we make these comments, and we sort of think, oh, I'm very friendly. I just ask that person how they are. And often they reply something back, or they even say, I'm good, how's your day? Do you know what I notice? Well, Jennifer notices more because she'll give me a dig and goes, you never answered that person because you just kept on walking. We all do it, don't we? Or is it just me? Make me feel good. Tell me you all do that. Oh, no, there's a lot of shaking head. No, go on. No. Yeah. You can repent of all those things before you come to communion this morning. But it's Jesus wants to have this deep relationship with us. And when Jesus has that deep relationship, it changes everything about us. So how do you and I respond to knowing that Jesus wants to be close to you? Are we afraid of that? Are we skeptical? Or are we all in, ready to give Jesus this rightful place in our lives? And that rightful place is number one. He's not second place, and he's not third place. He's top of the podium. He's number one in our lives. He deserves more from us. He really does. Not just our second best or our throwaway best. We'll fit you in when we can fit you in. When we surrender to him, everything that used to drive us forward should change, because Jesus should be the one driving us forward. Romans 6:6-8 says this: could it be any clearer? Our old way of life was nailed to the cross with Christ. A decisive end to that sin miserable life, no longer captive to sin's demands. What we believe is this: if we get included in Christ's sin conquering death, we will also get included in his life saving resurrection. We know that when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was the signal of the end of death as the end. Never again would death have the last word. We have a hope, and we have an eternity with Jesus when we accept him, when we follow him, when we have him as Lord and Savior of your lives. Anybody ever seen these celebrity lookalikes? There's people who earn a fortune being hired out for parties because they look like somebody else. You've seen them? And some of them are really good. And some of them I look at and think, who are you? Who are you supposed to be? I think Jesus sometimes will look at us and say, who are you? Because you're not who you're supposed to be. You can have an uncanny likeness, and these celebrity lookalikes, yeah, they some of them have a real likeness, but they're never the real deal. They're never the real deal. They're just imitators. That's all they are. You're paying for somebody to imitate Elvis, because Elvis is not going to be able to come to your party. In fact, none of these celebrities are going to come to any parties that we throw, all right? So unless you're in the know somewhere, you know, unless you have a cousin or an uncle or somebody in the family who's a celebrity, it's going to be very hard to get them to come to your party. Well, it's not. If you have a whole lot of money and you offer to them, they'll probably come. But that's not the reason why you want to have somebody at a party. They're imitators. Now, for us to be like Jesus, it's not produced by imitation. It doesn't happen by us imitating who we think Jesus is. It's produced by inhabitation. Not imitation, but inhabitation. We let Jesus live in us and through us. That verse from Colossians 1:27 says, this is the secret. Christ lives in you. But how can this happen in our everyday lives? How can Christ live in me and change me? Well, it happens simply through the choices that we make. It's about choosing to do the right thing and then trusting in God's Spirit to give us the power, the love, the faith, and the wisdom to win the day. See, it's all down to Him. One thing always remains, and that's Jesus. Because God's Spirit is living within us, all who have given their lives to Him have everything readily available, always on tap. It's always on tap. We just have to ask. It's there in front of us, and yet we don't see it. Why is that? Why do we not see it? And what a shame that we are afraid to ask the one who loves us so much that He hung on a cross to help us and to fill us and to be with us. Here we are, right here, right now, and God has an abundant life for each one of us. Abundant. Abundant life. Not just it's a pretty good life. It's an abundant life that He has for us. And He wants each of us to enjoy it. He doesn't want us to shy away and say, no, thank you. He wants us to open our arms and say, please give me that. I really want it. What do we need in our lives? What do you need in your life? All you need is Jesus. I can't put it any simpler than that. It's just this Jesus. It's just Jesus. That's it. Stop searching for the next fix and just turn to Him. John 6:35 tells us, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. The person who aligns with me hungers no more and thirsts no more ever. And today we're invited to come for communion. And remember this love and this sacrifice that Jesus has for us. His body broken, His blood shed. Why? Why, Jesus, did you go through that? It's simple. He adores you. He treasures you. Each one of us are loved by God, loved by Jesus. He was willing to give His all for us, and he doesn't even plead. He just hopes that we will give our all to Him. He doesn't get angry at us. He just hopes that one day we'll realize what we should give to Him. So let me ask you to ponder these things as you come forward for communion in a few moments. We will do communion as we've done lately. We'll just make your way down to John here, and John will give you the bread and come across and have the cup and just drop the cup into the trash. But this is a special time, and as you come, take your time coming and think of these things. Does Jesus have full control of your life? I want you to be really honest with us, because there's no point us going, yeah, and God sitting going, no, because He knows the answers. But sometimes, and most of the time, we have to realize who we really are so that we can come closer to Him. So does He have full control of your life? Is your life full of joy? The joy that He gives us each day. That's it. You know, if you're always feeling miserable, get a little bit more Jesus, all right? Because He changes everything. He gives us a joy that stays in our hearts. There's a difference between joy and happiness. Happiness is something that, somebody just give me a bar of chocolate, I'm really happy. But when the bar of chocolate's over, I'm waiting for the next bar to become happy again. That's not the way Jesus wants us to be. Jesus wants this joy that He gives us to be in our hearts, that bubbles out of us, that overflows, that makes others go, why are you so happy? How do we respond? If somebody asked you, why are you so happy? I know how I used to respond. It used to be, that's just the way I am. When the answer should be, it's just about because I have Jesus. It's as simple as that. They've asked you a question, give them the answer. Why are you so happy? Oh, it's all about Jesus. That's what God's looking us to do. And as we come here today, let's ask him for more joy. Are we ready to witness for him? Everybody gets it. Oh, witness, witness. No, 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 no. I'm too shy. I'm too quiet. I don't do that. That's not my personality. But if somebody asks you a question just to mention Jesus as a witness, it doesn't say, are you ready to give everybody a sermon about Jesus? It says witness. And witness happens just through our lives as well, through the things that we do, the choices that we make. Do we find strength in God's word to get us through every day? And are our priorities based on his kingdom or based on the world? Big questions to consider as you come. So I want you to take a moment to stop and think as you come for communion. Of all that Jesus has done for you, and remember as we take the Lord's Supper, the great price that Jesus paid for us. Let's examine our hearts today. Let's repent of all the stuff that's in our lives that shouldn't be. Let's forgive others the way we have been forgiven. Let's treat the Lord's Supper as a privilege. Privilege to remember Jesus and the sacrifice, the bread and the wine. It's a privilege. It's a celebration. The most important thing is for us to ask God's Holy Spirit to be present not only in this place, and he is, he's here, but in our lives, the very heart of our beings. I don't think you realize this, but there is a celebrity. And there's royalty with us today. I'm watching the faces here. It's Jesus. We're in the presence of royalty. We're in presence of the one that we should be looking to get to know, to become more like. He's the King of Kings. He's the Almighty God. Now will you come and receive from him? And here's the most important thing. When we receive, will we leave this place as a different person? Because we should, because we have met in his presence, we've been touched by his spirit, and he changes everything when we let him. When all seems to be falling apart, one thing remains, Jesus. When you're going through a bad time, remember Jesus. When things are hard, remember Jesus. He changes everything. He wants to take us by the hand, and he wants to walk with us from this place as different people who are restored and redeemed. John's going to join us, and we're going to get ready to receive. Think of those things and be changed.
Today we're coming to the table of the Lord, and I appreciate what Brother Keith said. We are in Christ. He is in us. And we must identify with him in his death, his burial, his resurrection. Every day, new life that he gives us, we can have that joy that only Christ can give us. And then someday that we're going to spend eternity with him. Everything we need, we have in Christ. We don't need anything else, really. He's given us all. And so today, as we come to share both of the bread and the cup together, I pray that as you take that, you will just pause for a moment and say, Lord, none of us are worthy to receive this, but today we thank you so much that you were willing to give all for us. What a great privilege it is today. It's a privilege, not a duty. It's not a ritual we're going through. This is a relationship, closer relationship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit is present here today. Let's come and ask Him to forgive us of our sins, and as we take this cup and this bread together, we will share in fellowship with Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Before we come today, I want to say a prayer over the bread. Would you bow? And then I'm going to ask Brother Keith if he would say a prayer over the cup. We thank you, Lord, for your great sacrifice so that we could have new life. I pray, Lord, today as we come, we'll realize that this bread represents your body broken for us. Your body that took the stripes upon your back, the nails in your hands and your feet, the crown of thorns pressed into your head, the spear that was thrust into your side. All of that, Lord, so that we could identify with you and know that even though we have faults and we come today with many faults, you are sinless. And today we receive this sacred privilege, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. The bread, we ask you to bless it today, Lord. Make it very special to us as we receive it together. Brother Keith.
And Lord, we thank you for your blood shed for us, poured out on the cross to redeem us, to defeat death, Amen. And to give us the hope of eternal life. Lord, as we take of the bread and the wine, help us to remember you. Help us to give ourselves to you. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we ask you just to come down this aisle and back to your seats this way here? Thank you. Thank you. Let's just bow our heads before we sing our last song. Let's just take a moment of silence as we reflect. Lord, thank you. Thank you for loving us so much. Thank you for dying on a cross for us. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your presence and your Holy Spirit to live within us. Lord, we just want to leave this place different. We have met with you. Change is everything. So we lift our hearts to you. We give you our lives and we go from this place. Different people. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a new song. Hopefully you like it. We're singing it anyway. There's no other option. But it's a beautiful song about communion. It's got a really clever title. It's called Communion Song. And it just speaks of the sacrifice. It speaks of... It's really a prayer, and it's a praise song that we can really go out of here, hopefully with these words in our hearts. It's called Communion Song.
Let me reveal who I am.
Let's bow our heads. We cry worthy. We cry worthy of the Lamb of God. The Lamb that was slain, the blood that was shed, his body given for us so that we could have life. Lord, we have met with you today. We've been in your presence, and that changes us. At least it should. So let us go from here changed, renewed, redeemed, and know that no matter what happens in life, one thing remains. There's always Jesus. Amen. Have a great week. Please join us at the back. We'd love to spend some time with you.